Hi, my name is Papon. I'm currently in fourth year undergraduate student in Bio and Brain Department. So what I'm going to present about today is the interferon biotechnology. So let's first talk about the timeline of the therapeutic effect of the interferon. In late 1950s, initial therapeutic application was rendered impractical due to extremely low levels of production in the body levels, at which they are normally produced in the body. Furthermore, interferons exhibit species preference and in some cases, strict species specificity. This rendered necessary the clinical use only human-derived interferons in human medicine. Up until 1970s, interferon was sourced directly from human leukocytes, obtained from transfused blood supplies. And in the late 1970s, the production of interferon in significant quantities first became possible by means of mammalian cell culture. Moreover, hybridoma technology facilitated development of sensitive interferon immunoassays. In 1980s, recombinant DNA technology also facilitated the production of interferons in quantities large enough to satisfy potential medical needs. So up to now, most interferons have now been produced in a variety of expression systems, including E. coli, fungi, yeast, and some mammalian cell lines, such as CHO cell lines. So now let's first talk about the first type of interferon, which is interferon alpha. It has been shown that interferon alpha could induce regression of tumors in significant numbers of patients suffering from breast cancer, lymphomas, and other types of cancers. The first recombinant interferon to become available for clinical studies was interferon alpha 2A. The antiviral anti-tumor properties of these interferons ensure their approval for a variety of medical uses. Clinical trials have shown the recombinant interferons to be effective in the treatment of various cancer types. The recombinant human interferon has been approved for the treatment of hairy cell leukemia, and also they have been proven effective in the treatment of various viral conditions, most notably viral hepatitis, which refers to an inflammation to the liver. Furthermore, the recombinant human interferon alpha 2B is already approved for the treatment of sexually transmitted genital warts caused by the human papilloma virus. More recently, a number of modified recombinant interferon products have also gained marketing approval. These include the pegylated interferons and the synthetic interferon product Infergen. The pegylated interferons are generated by reacting purified interferon alpha with a chemically activated form of PEG or polyethylene glycol. This product displays a significantly prolonged plasma half-life, and this prolonged plasma half-life appears to be due to mainly slower elimination of the molecule. Infergen is an engineered interferon recently approved for the treatment of hepatitis C. In common, producer microorganism of these interferon alphas is E. coli, which harbors a cytoplasmic expression vector containing the interferon gene. For the manufacturing process, it can be separated into two main parts, which are upstream processing and downstream processing, which are physically separated by being undertaken in separate building. The upstream part refers to the first step in which microbes or cells are grown, while the downstream part refers to the part where the cells mass from the upstream are processed to meet purity and quality requirements. So now let's move to another type of interferon, interferon beta. The recombinant human interferon beta has found medical application in the treatment of relapsing remitting multiple sclerosis, or in short, MS, which is a chronic disease of the nervous system. This disease normally presents in young adults, ages from 20 to 40 years. It is characterized by the damage to the myelin sheath, which surrounds neurons of the central nervous system, and in this way compromises neural function. The molecular mechanism by which interferon beta increases its therapeutic effect is complex and not fully understood. It is believed that the pathology of this MS disease is linked to the activation of T lymphocytes, which trigger an inflammatory response mediated by the production of pro-inflammatory cytokines. So this results in the destruction of myelin surrounding neuronal axons. The interferon beta is likely to counteract these effects, in part at least, by inhibiting production of interferon gamma and also and other cytokines. And hence, this mediates the down regulation of the pro-inflammatory response. The interferon beta preparations approved for medical use to date include betaferon and betaseron, which are produced in recombinant E. coli, and alphonix and rebif, which are produced in CHO cell lines. So this figure here shows an overview of the manufacture of betaferon, which is a recombinant human interferon beta produced in E. coli. As you can see in the left figure, the E. coli fermentation is achieved using minimal salts or glucose media, which is shown in detail in the right-hand side figure. And during the downstream processing, the inclusion bodies form of this are solubilized in butanol. And after that, it will pass to the purification process, which yield to the final product at the end. And let's move to another type of interferon, which is interferon gamma. The most notable medical application of interferon gamma relates to the treatment of CGD, which is a rare genetic condition. The phagocytic cells of patients suffering from CGD are incapable of ingesting and destroying infectious agents, such as bacteria or protozoa. So in this case, phagocytic cells have difficulty forming the reactive oxygen compounds. And so this figure below shows the production of reactive oxygen species by phagocytes. The reactive oxygen compounds are produced by an NADPH oxidase system, the main feature of which is a plasma membrane-based electron transport chain. The electrons are passed via a number of carriers, which lead to the cytochrome, and then which will pass the electron to the oxygen, generating a superoxide anion, which can be converted to hydrogen peroxide at the end. So it has been found that the administration of the interferon gamma can treat this disease. So for the molecular mechanism, interferon gamma can potentiate the ability of phagocytes to generate toxic oxidative products by boosting flux through the NADPH oxidative system, which then used to kill the infectious agents. Also, interferon gamma can promote increased expression of immunoglobulin Fc receptors on the surface of phagocytes. This would increase a phagocyte ability to destroy opsonized infectious agents. And also, the interferon gamma proved valuable in treating leishmaniasis, which is a disease common in tropical and subtropical region, which caused by a parasitic protozoan of the genus Leishmania. The interferon gamma also appears to stimulate the infected macrophage to produce nitric oxide, which is toxic for this parasite. Additional studies illustrate that interferon gamma can also stimulate the phagocytic activation for the treatment of AIDS and another disease. Okay, so far you guys have studied about the three main types of interferons. So now I will move on to the interferon toxicity. So like most drugs, the administration of interferons can also elicit a number of unwanted side effects. This table, as you can see, shows the side effects of interferon alphas. In most cases, only minor side effects are noted. However, more serious effects may occur in up to 17% of patients. And also, the administration of other types of interferons like interferons beta and interferons gamma can also cause the serious side effects if it's consumed in a high doses, as shown in the slide here. For example, it can induce the menstrual disorder or also the hypersensitivity. Yes. So, however, the common side effects associated with almost all types of these interferons is the characteristic flu-like symptoms. So besides the three main types of interferons that I have mentioned, there are also various types of additional interferons. It has been found that a protein called tofobrastim was closely related to interferon alpha. The functional studies have proven this. These studies show that tofobrastim display many functions that are similar to interferon alpha. Therefore, it has been named interferon tau and is classified as a type 1 interferon. Interferon tau is currently generating considerable clinical interest. It induces effects similar to type 1 interferon, but it appears to exhibit significantly lower toxicity. Therefore, it may prove possible to be an alternative effective interferon. Another type of additional interferon is interferon omega, which represents an additional member of type 1 interferon family. This interferon induces its antiviral and other effects by binding the type 1 interferon receptor. Okay, so far we have learned about three main type interferons, which are interferon alpha, interferon beta, and also gamma. So interferon represents an important family of biopharmaceutical products. And also we have learned about the production of interferons, which include two main parts, upstream processing and downstream processing. For the upstream processing, it includes the fermentation or the growth of the cells. And for the downstream processing, it includes the purification and also the formulation of the product. For interferon alpha, the main medical uses are the treatment of hairy cell leukemia and also the hepatitis. And in case of interferon beta, is well known for the treatment of relapsing remitting multiple sclerosis disease, or in short, MS disease. And for interferon gamma, it's also known as the treatment of CGD disease, and also it can stimulate the phagocytic activity. And we have talked about the interferon toxicity, which can also cause the unwanted side effects like other common drugs, which include the flu-like symptoms. And also, it can cause the serious side effects like depression and anxiety.